Welcome back to another episode of Harmonious at Lunch, the show that fuels your business success. I'm Brandon Gano, your host and guide through the world of harmonious business growth. Today, we're unlocking powerful strategies with industry experts to help your business thrive. If you're a business owner, entrepreneur, or executive, you are in the right place. Join me and our incredible guest today on the journey to clarity, growth, and success. It is time to revolutionize your approach to business. Let's dive in with another episode of Harmonious at Lunch. Welcome back to some more bite-sized business advice. We got an awesome episode lined up today about how your self-talk is killing your happiness. We're going to talk about mental health. We're going to talk about growing your business, getting out of your own way, and maybe most importantly, why you're not lazy, even if you call yourself lazy. So I have an awesome guest lined up here, Georgia Homsany, and we're going to talk about all those things. But before we get there, Georgia, welcome to the show. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Brandon. Happy to be here. That was a nice little intro tidbit that the podcast does. I like that.
Oh, you like that?
Revolutionize your business. I'm like, yeah, let's do it.
Before we ruin it, should we just wrap up and just say that's it? Like,
there would be a lot of disappointed listeners. They're like, great, let's hear how we're going to do this.
It's a cliffhanger for the next episode. We can't help you. Yes, we can, because you're not lazy and we need to talk about mental health. So let's unpack this. I always say on the show, it's more than just a business show. We don't just talk about business, because in order to have a successful business, you need to be a whole human being too. You need your mindset, your body, your health, your spirit to be intact, and your life. I mean, your life and your business should be two separate things. You can't just focus on business. So we're going to talk about mental health, mindset, self-talk. It's killing your happiness. That seems a little dramatic, Georgia. Why is your self-talk killing your happiness?
Does it get your attention? That's the point of it.
Yeah, I love clickbait. This whole show is founded on clickbait titles. So
I will say that I use that in marketing, but people wanted me to have that as the subtitle of the book, and I really didn't want the word kill on the title. So the actual book subtitle, it's, well, You're Not Lazy is the title, and then it's Change Your Words to Change Your Worth. So that's the softer version for you, if you're more comfortable with that.
I'm cool either way. We've talked about a variety of things on this show. Maybe some taboo topics. I'm sure that's
don't go there. Don't go there with me, because I'm from New Jersey. So I'll say something that gets me in trouble, because I just say it how it is.
As am I. So we have the New Jersey thing in common. Yeah. There's no political correctness here. We're gonna say how we feel. If people don't like us, that's fine, because we're going to speak the truth to them out of love. Cool? Are we cool? Yeah, let's do it then. Why is our self-talk killing our happiness? I have to know.
Okay. So when I was researching the book, this stat astounded me. But every day, the average person has between 60,000 and 80,000 thoughts, which seems impossible to me. But out of all of those thoughts, 80% are negative. So if you're constantly fueling yourself with negative self-talk, it's impossible that that wouldn't have an impact on you. So if I'm, and a lot of it's subconscious, right? So it's not like you're sitting there all day like, I suck at life, I'm this, I'm that. But a lot of it's just thoughts that have been ingrained in us our whole lifetime, maybe from a job or a teacher or a parent. And they're almost just like in the background in our subconscious. So if you're not aware of that and these negative thoughts are flooding your brain 80% of the time in a given day, it's just impossible that it wouldn't impact you. So it's going to affect our confidence. And so really what I try to help people do is just make them aware of this, because a lot of times we'll say things negatively and not even realize that we're saying it about ourselves.
Yeah, I think you could tell when people speak too, because they have just a naturally, maybe victim mindset is the wrong term, but you can tell it because they victimize themselves in every situation. Is that one of the ways you identify how someone's talking to themselves?
I would say more often it's people that are apologetic. So I talk about how many times in a day we say, I'm sorry. Most people say it 8 to 10 times a day. Like we're getting on a meeting for work and think about, like, before you speak, and people are like, I'm sorry, I just want to say one thing. Like we're so apologetic for so much that we do. And once again, I don't think people realize, and they're probably sitting here like, oh yeah, I do do that, but why does that matter? And it matters because if all of these things have a negative association to them. So once again, if it's negative, negative, negative thought, negative, 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 we're just not going to have the self-esteem that we need to in order to show up in a positive way in whatever we do. So think about when you're hanging out with your friends. I mean, and women are worse at this. I know it's a stereotype, but it's true. You go out with your friends, and if someone says, oh my gosh, I love your outfit. Oh no, this I look fat in this. We like immediately go to everything that's wrong. Or, well, but my hair looks horrible today, or blah, blah, blah. And we just, it's just amazing. But if you start to pay attention, you'll realize how much people are going back on compliments. They can't just accept a compliment, or you're in a coffee shop. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to step by you, and just things that maybe we don't need to be apologizing for.
Yeah. That's interesting. I never thought about the sorry or the apologizing side of it. How does that make other people perceive you though?
Well, that's hard to answer because, you know, I'm not inside everyone else's head, but
why not? First of all, I mean,
well, okay. Because I realized over my lifetime, the way I think is the way most people don't think. So I won't make that assumption to try and think I know what people what's going through their heads. But I imagine if someone's coming off like that, to me, they seem meek. They seem like they have a lack of confidence, maybe insecure. And depending on what it is, they seem nice though, if they're apologetic and they're, you know, kind of putting themselves down. I feel bad for them sometimes, but is that someone that you're going to want to hire to run your sales team? Probably not. I wouldn't have confidence in that person. So
yeah, and I'm
am I going to hire them to grow my business? Probably not, because they don't seem confident in themselves. So then that would make me question my confidence in them.
Right. And it, you know, you bring up sales and business, which is what I was going to ask you about next, because that's huge in business is the confidence you come up with, or you come into anything with, whether it's a meeting, a sales conversation, a review of an employee, you have to present yourself a certain way to have respect for other people, to have respect for you. So what are some of the kind of notable, if you will, physical portrayals of negative self-talk? Because I would imagine your body language tells most of the story when you're telling yourself all these negative thoughts all day. Can you like specifically tell the difference in people before you even interact with them?
Ooh, I've never been asked that before, but it is an interesting question because you're right. There's got to be a correlation. I think the one thing that comes to mind would be posture. So, and this ties into presenting. If you see someone that's giving a presentation and they call it a power pose, if you're kind of shoulders back, standing up tall, yeah, you've got it. But, you know, if we're kind of hunched in and, you know, shoulders in, we're slouching and it's kind of like, I'm sorry, but don't hit me, but, you know, don't yell at me. You know, we're kind of scared at what the outcome's going to be. So that's what would come to mind for me as far as body language.
Okay. That makes sense. And I think more importantly than identifying it in others is identifying it in ourselves, right? And getting past it and starting to fill our mind with more positive, uplifting thoughts. So what can we, I think it's important to know how to identify it. So how do you help people identify in themselves that they're doing it? Because the sorry thing, the apologizing was new to me. I've never heard that. And now I'm like going back in my head, do I say sorry or do I say like piss off? And I don't think there's either one of those is good. We need to find that middle road of positive self-talk.
It's your Jersey coming out. You're
like, exactly right. Yeah. That's dangerous. Don't be like Jersey people, wherever you're from, even Jersey people.
We're rough around the edges.
Yeah, exactly. So how do we identify in ourselves the negativity that we're preaching to ourselves 80% of the time? And then how do we start to get out of that and help be more positive?
Yeah. So I talk about this in the book. There's three steps I try and walk people through. The first is to have the awareness, right? Because if you lack self-awareness, then there's nothing to change because you don't even realize that there's a problem. So the first step would be, I call it identify your ROR. So what's your record on repeat? What are the sayings that you keep saying to yourself? Because out of the 60 to 80,000 negative thoughts we're having each day, 80% are negative, but 90% are repetitive. So find out what are the ones that keep coming up. And it's probably things that you've been saying, maybe someone told you as a child that you're then adopting as an adult. So there should be certain sayings that are on repeat. So I try to get people to start with that, the things that are the most common. Okay. So first, identifying what those are. The second is catching yourself saying them and then try to just stop. So I call it catch and release. So if you're like, oh, I'm so lazy, I didn't go to the gym today, try and as you're saying it, just try to identify it in that moment and prevent yourself from completing the thought. So that's two. And then three is when we work on reframing. And there's a couple of different steps I walk people through because it's different. It's very difficult to just go from one extreme to the next. So if you think you're unattractive and then one day you just start saying, I'm beautiful, and you don't believe it, there needs to be some middle stepping stones. So I try to tell people either just say something neutral. So, you know, if you hate your hair, you could just say, I have hair. It's not negative or positive. And it does sound weird. I get that. So I'm with you. But there's no negative or positive, but you're just saying something that's factual. And then once you're able to get to that neutral zone, you feel comfortable with that, then I move people over into saying something positive. Another alternative is to focus on something you actually believe. So if you don't, using that same example, if you don't like your hair, instead of just saying, I have beautiful hair, you could say, I love my eyes, or I have really pretty eyes, or focus on something that you already do believe that is positive. And then the third part is trying to reframe, but it's after we've already kind of gotten a bit of experience neutralizing things, focusing on other positive things so that we're adapting to more of that positive mindset. And then it's reframing whatever that negative thought was. And the interesting thing, I mean, the brain is so powerful. So the more that we say things over and over, we start to believe it. So if we don't believe it at first, over time, our brain will start to believe whatever we're telling it.
Yeah. And that's good and bad, right? I mean, we've seen the historical examples of where this kind of plays out. Let's just say 1940s Germany. That would be an extreme example of where we say things then over and over and over and we believe them. But I think where this takes place in business on a day-to-day basis, I'm curious, that's talking about yourself, which is very powerful. How does this work with our business? If we say things like, my business isn't growing, or I'm not good at marketing, or I don't know how to do this. I mean, yeah, there are certain things as an entrepreneur and everybody in our business that we are good at and that we're just naturally not good at, and we should delegate accordingly. That being said, how do we start to reverse this self-talk with our business? Does it have the same effect if it's about an external object or like a business as it does when you talk about yourself internally?
Yeah, I mean, and it, you know, I don't know if the audience here, if we're believers in the law of attraction and manifestation and all that, I think it's very polarizing. So I think you either believe or you don't. But a lot of that thinking ties into this. And it's, you know, the universe will basically take anything that you're saying and fulfill it. So if you're saying my business isn't growing, then it's almost a self-fulfilling prophecy, and that's what you're going to manifest more of. So if you believe that, then yes, it's very detrimental to your business, and you have to be careful of what you're saying. But I mean, The reality is, and you know, an example I've used is I used to always say, I'm bad with numbers. I'm more of a writer, you know, SATs, bomb the math part of it. So, but instead of, even if that may be true that I'm not good at numbers, I can just focus on what I am good at. And just once again, just catching myself saying that, releasing that thought and filling it with something that is positive. So I can hire someone to be my CFO without me saying I'm bad at numbers, so I'm hiring a CFO. See what I'm saying? So you could reframe I would work on someone with is saying, I am really strong at marketing and operations, and I'm going to bring someone on that's strong in finance to help complement my strengths. See how that's a lot different than I suck at numbers, so I need to hire a CFO.
Yeah, because it gives you the excuse too of like, I suck at numbers, so I don't have to look at them is the completion of that phrase.
Yes. And the other thing too is a lot of these thoughts may have no validity to them. It might have been something, you know, a parent or a teacher told us 40 years ago that just because someone told us once, we've latched onto it and now it's totally impacting us as an adult.
Yeah.
And a business owner or a CEO, whatever it
is. Yeah, those things, they tend to come back up in the most inconvenient places too, right? Where it, you're running a business and you say, I hate numbers. Guess what, sister? You got to know your numbers to run a business. Like there's no way around it to some degree. And a lot of this stuff too, I mean, it's stories that you tell yourself, like you've been saying, which is probably, if I had to guess, where the title of the book, You're Not Lazy, comes from. So I put your website on the screen here to go grab the book. Wherever you're watching and listening, it's also in the show notes down below. But tell me, what's the purpose behind writing this book? And really around the title too, I think it's interesting.
Yeah, it's really just to make people aware. So, you know, I was mentioning to you before we hopped on here that it was actually a couple friends of mine that would just constantly call themselves lazy. And these are people that have jobs, have their finances in order. They own condos. I mean, they have their stuff together. They are not lazy people. They would have never gotten to where they are if they were. But if you dig in to why they're saying that, it's because they, like my one friend, for example, because she went to the pool all weekend and didn't go to the gym. Okay, why is that wrong? Like our culture, it's almost like we've been conditioned to think that if we're not productive 24/7, then, you know, we're lazy or we're not ambitious, or this is why we don't have enough money and, you know, work harder, keep going, go, go, go. And it's just, we, especially in America, I feel like we have this workhorse mentality. And so the purpose of the book is to really just get you thinking about it. I don't like telling people what to do. So if it resonates with you, great. If not, I'm not offended, because you have to want to change. So if you're sitting there thinking, oh, my self-talk is fine, then great. Hopefully you have that confidence. But I imagine that the majority of people are saying something negative, even if it is the 8 to 10 apologies a day, right? And that saying I'm sorry is almost admitting fault, like you're doing something wrong. So I think anyone can benefit, at least take some sort of snippet out of the book. And, you know, it talks about a lot of our inputs, like how are we being filled with these negative thoughts, you know, watching the news, going on social media. So I think there's a lot in there. And once again, I'm not here to tell you what to do. I'm just trying to help people see the picture and open up their eyes to the things that are going to impact their words, and then why that matters and why we should care.
She's not here to tell you what to do. I am. I need you to go to their website and check out the book. It's in the show notes. And also,
if you are loving what you're reading in the book, there is a 90-day self-talk masterclass that people can do. Because another thing I think, Brandon, is someone can listen to this or read a book or, you know, listen to a podcast and say, great, that was valuable information, but it's so difficult to make change. So the point of the masterclass is really to help give you that next level of support where every month I'm giving you something to work on to reframe that negative self-talk.
Yeah, perfect segue, because that's what this podcast is all about. You can't listen to a 20-minute episode and have your life change. There's just, it's impossible. What's inside of George's head, you cannot get in 20 minutes. And it's knowledge that could probably change your life about your self-talk. And it could help you be more positive and truly change your life. I've seen it. I've been on both sides of the negative self-talk. And it is truly life-changing. It's about, if this resonates with you, if you think you're being held back by negative self-talk, if you're calling yourself an idiot 25 times a day, you need to do something about it. So do something about it. For those of you who don't have this issue, fantastic. We'll see you on tomorrow's episode of Harmonious at Lunch. But for those of you who could benefit, I want you to do something about it, because this is probably the one thing, and Georgia, correct me if I'm wrong, this will hold people back more than anything else in their lives. Am I crazy to say that?
Yeah. And even though it's not easy, it's still free to change your thoughts, and it's in our control. So a lot of times we try and seek out things that aren't in our control. These are things that you can do. You don't need anyone else to do them. Read the book so you're aware of them, but then it's up to you at the end of the day. So it doesn't cost any money. You just need to want to make change.
Yes, do that. Do all of those things. Georgia, thank you so much for coming here and unpacking this with me.
Thank you.
This has been awesome.
Connect with me on LinkedIn, y'all, too.
That sounds awesome. We'll put that in the show notes down below, too. For those of you watching, listening, wherever you are, if you need it, go grab the book. If you don't, subscribe. Even if you need the book, subscribe to Harmonious at Lunch. We want to see you back on the next episode. Make sure you keep coming back day after day so we can disrupt the way you think about growing your business, get you out of that little box you're stuck in, and get you to that next level. We'll see you on tomorrow's episode of Harmonious at Lunch. Thank